Okay, everybody. This week we're going to discuss the perceptron learning algorithms, and then we will consider multi-layer perceptron and error backpropagation. First, we're going to consider the single neuron case. As you know from the previous weeks of this course, this is a single neuron structure. There are inputs called U1, U2, UM, and associated adjustable parameters, Phi1, Phi2, Phi m, m inputs. And there's a bias input, -1 or +1, it doesn't matter. And there's a bias multiplier, theta. Together with all these values, we obtain this Phi transpose U minus theta, that is the net summation that you obtain here. And you pass this net summation through the nonlinear activation function f to get tau. Tau is the output or response of a single neuron. To be more explicit, tau is equal to f of, this is the argument of f, the variable of f. I runs from 1 to m, phi I times ui. You compute the summation and subtract the value of theta from this summation. This minus comes from this -1. To obtain the output, okay? And in this hour, we're gonna discuss how this works for classification purposes. And this model, you know, is the building block for interconnected networks. I mean, within the context of neural networks. And we're gonna consider several tuning mechanisms, several tuning laws and their properties while discussing the classification of a simple classification problem. The problem here, as you know, there are adjustable parameters, phi's and theta, that is this nonlinear activation function. When you present a neuron, when you present an input vector to this neuron, you get the output of it, but there is your desired value. So the error is defined as the difference between the desired value that is provided by a teacher or a supervisor or a user, okay, and the response of the neuron, okay, response of the neuron. So these d minus tau is defined to be e, which is error. Using this error value, the update mechanism computes the new values of phi1, phi2, dot, 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 phi m, and theta. Okay, this update mechanism finds the new values of those adjustable parameters and writes those new values to the places of those adjustable values. Okay, this is one step of parameter update. Basically, you have a law, a rule that changes, that tunes the values of your adjustable parameters to obtain a better response. Basically, if you run this loop for some time, you should be expecting a lower error values in some norm, let's say. Let's say you take the magnitude of this quantity, and you're observing that the magnitude of the error is decreasing. This means that your single perceptron is learning the behavior defined implicitly by your desired values here, okay? For this, we define a generic pair, generic input-output pair as a row vector, okay? This row contains U1, U2, UM, for a particular pattern, and the corresponding desired value is here. So a generic pair contains m plus one elements, okay? In this part of the lecture, I will introduce four different learning algorithms to tune the parameters of a perceptron. Here is the first algorithm, okay? We're going to initialize the weights and the bias of the single neuron to randomly selected small numbers. And we can apply a pattern to obtain the output tau. And we're going to calculate the error, which is the d minus tau. We know the value of the desired output. Okay. And we're going to adapt the weights of our neuron. And we will choose an eta, which is the learning rate. And our tuning law is given by the new value of the ith element of the phi vector is equal to its old value plus eta times error times ui. So you take the phi I value, okay, you multiply eta times phi I times, okay, eta times error times ui. Eta is the learning rate that multiplies the corrective information. It is important, we will discuss it, okay? So when it comes to theta, that is the bias value, you add the old value, you take the old value plus eta times error times the corresponding input value. Now our input, our nonlinear activation function is 1 when its argument is 0 or positive. It is minus 1 when its argument is negative. Okay. Eta is chosen in between 0 and 1, which is a positive value that determines the step size for each step. And this learning algorithm is called the Hebbian learning in the literature. Okay. Okay. We will now consider the MIT rule, which is discovered in Massachusetts Institute of Technology in some years ago, in 1950s or 60s. This is called the gradient descent, or alternatively, the researchers call it as steepest descent. And its application to neural networks results in the error backpropagation algorithm we will discuss in the coming lectures, okay? The gradient descent algorithm is the following. Basically, you have a cost function or a loss function that is quadratic in the adjustable parameters, okay? That is called JR, okay? JR is equal to 1 over 2 times phi squared. This blue curve is JR, okay? This blue curve is JR. It is basically centered at the origin. But in a particular application, you can consider a different algorithm, different cost function, okay? So, you know that when you take the partial derivative of this, well, this function with respect to this argument, phi, you're gonna get this red line. When you take the partial derivative with respect to phi, you get phi, which is a positive one, positive slope one. And when you take the negative direction of it, you get this information. Basically, this is telling me that if you move toward the negative gradient direction, you find the optimal value. This is telling me that you are on the left-hand side and the derivative is positive. So you are here, this phi, the current phi value is here. The derivative is, negative derivative is positive. So I would increase the value. Still the derivative is positive, I would increase the value. Still the derivative is positive, I would increase the value till I get the optimum point here. So the minimum point of this cost function is found by following the negative gradient direction. And the same explanation is valid also for the values that are on the right-hand side. Say, for example, you are here, okay? For the next phi value, you will update the phi value according to the negative gradient direction. The gradient is positive. Gradient is negative here. I'm sorry. The gradient is negative here, okay? So these values go up to here, okay? Not up until the blue one. The gradient is negative, so decrease the value. Again, the gradient is negative, as you see, decrease the value. Again, the gradient is negative, decrease the value. So MIT rule is telling me that update your parameters toward the negative gradient direction. Okay, now we're gonna adapt, we're gonna apply this approach to single perceptron to obtain the gradient descent based update of a perceptron weight. Okay, now our cost function is JR is equal to 1 over 2 E square. E is equal to D minus tau. Okay, and the gradient descent is telling me that the delta phi value, phi k plus 1 is equal to phi k plus delta phi. Okay, so phi k delta phi value is minus eta times del JR over del phi I. Let's take the partial derivative. Delta phi is equal to minus eta, this is fixed, times, now this is, we're going to take the partial derivative of this whole quantity with respect to phi. First, I will take the partial derivative with respect to E. That is E times del E over del phi I. So this is telling me that minus eta d minus tau times del d over del, well, this is here, del d over del phi I, minus del phi, del tau over del phi I. This is zero because d does not depend on phi I. So this minus and this minus will be plus eta times error times del output over del parameter. Okay, eta times error times del output over del parameter, eta times error times del output over del parameter. Okay, let me go back. Well, let me go forth first. Okay, in the second algorithm, delta phi I is equal to eta times error times del tau over del phi I, eta times error times f prime of its argument times del argument over del phi I, that produces ui. Okay, it is here, it is here. Okay, it is within this thing. When it comes to the bias value, eta times error times del output over del phi I means eta times error times f prime of its argument times minus one. Remember, minus one comes from the coefficient or the multiplier of the bias value theta. Go back now. You see that minus one is here. Further go back. There was this piece of code. Phi k plus one is equal to phi k plus eta times error times the derivative of the function times ui. This is the vector wise multiplication of the quantity, okay? F times one minus F was the derivative of a what? Derivative of what? Remember, it was somewhere here. Yes, it is here. F times one minus F is the derivative of the sigmoid function. So this simple code snippet uses the MIT rule, this line uses the MIT rule for classification algorithm that is applied for this simple data, okay? So, MIT rule is the second approach for us. It is of course possible to use sigmoid function for, let's say, only positive outputs, okay? It is of course possible to use hyperbolic tangent, a bipolar function for plus positive and negative valued functions, okay? Again, the value of eta is in between 0 and 1, and eta is called the learning rate. And this tuning law is known as gradient descent or steepest descent or error back propagation, okay? This is a very famous algorithm. The second one is a very famous algorithm used in training large networks as well, okay? Used in training deep networks as well. Especially the final layer of the deep networks is tuned by using the gradient descent. We will understand at the end why this happens for deep networks, because this is particularly a simple algorithm that you can use for large structures that do not involve the matrix inversion at each step. Let's discuss the third algorithm and the fourth one, then we will see some examples, okay? In the third algorithm, we change the tuning law to this expression, this pair of expressions, okay? We initialize the weights and bias value to randomly selected small numbers. We present a pattern to obtain the output of the perceptron, and we adapt the weights using these two laws. For the values, phi values, we choose eta times 1 minus d tau times d ui is the phi values update value. And for the bias value, we choose this rule, and this minus 1 is the, you know, value that comes from the structure of our perceptron. And the output is a discontinuous function. It is 1 for its arguments 0 or positive. It is minus 1 for the negative argument. And eta is the same. It is chosen in between 0 and 1. It is the learning rate. Okay. And we come to fourth algorithm. This fourth algorithm, we start with initializing the weights and bias to the randomly selected small numbers. We present our pattern to obtain tau and adapt the weights using this law for the phis, this law, well, this should be phi, okay? This should be phi, right? For the phis and this one for the bias value. And the nonlinear function is a discontinuous one that is plus 1 when the argument is 0 or positive, minus 1 for the argument being negative. And eta is the learning rate that is in between 0 and 1, okay? This used to be the second homework for this course, and I will show you several, you know, moving pictures, GIF files, GIF pictures, to understand what is happening here, okay? This one is the first method. This one is the first method. And I'm showing you in this plot, I'm showing you the online surface that separates two classes of data, okay? For these two classes of data, eta value is 0.01, okay? And I run this for only 20 iterations. And in this plot, I show you the entire set of those planes on the same plot, okay? I do not delete those plots to show that there is really an effort to improve the separation performance, okay? There are two classes of data. Each one of them is having probably, yes, 50 samples for every class, okay? And there is a 0.2%, well, 0.2 units of overlap, which means that the corners are overlapping, okay? This set, this blue cross, is in between the third quadrant. This one is in the first quadrant, but there is an overlap in between around the origin. So this is producing this kind of a picture in the phi values, okay? This kind of a picture in the phi values, okay? So phi 1 is blue, phi 2 is orange, phi 3 is yellow. I'm seeing that there is a very quick recovery of the values, and those values go to some, let's say, steady state solution, whether or not convergent, but there is a kind of steady state solution. This is for the first method. And I understand that the two classes are separated by a separating hyperplane. Okay, I have three parameters, and I told you that the art of art of this neural networks discussion is to find the corrective information, find a tuning law that tunes the parameters that works for some goal, some optimization goal. Okay, this is for the first method. Let's go. In this slide, you see there are 80 samples per class. This one is for the first method, for the second method, for the third method, and for the fourth method, okay? And my algorithm runs for 20 steps. I do this algorithm, I run this algorithm for 20 steps. Okay, for each algorithm, I run my loop for 20 steps. And you see that, pay attention to this counter, okay? It converges. Now it's gonna start. Yes, it very quickly finds the separating hyperplane. And as time passes, I see some minor corrections in each case, okay? And there is a 0.1 amount of overlap in between those coordinates, okay? Let's say this is this kind of a coordinate, this is this kind of a coordinate, and this amount is 0.1 in between. Within this square, I have both elements, okay? Both elements that cannot be separated, okay? I have cross here and circle here. So these are making this classification task a little complicated, okay? And there is no bias means that this surface definitely passes through the origin, okay? We will consider the biased case in the coming GIF files, all right? So I see that all four algorithms are able to separate the two classes under these very nicely set up conditions, okay? Very nicely set conditions, so. For the GIF file, I have already shown you there were 80 samples per class, and the way my parameters evolve in the parameter space is important. Basically, method one produces this result, okay? Phi two and phi one are almost convergent, but this is increasing, right? This is increasing. Method two produces a gradually increasing parameter values, okay? This is producing a gradually increasing parameter values. Method three is similar to method one, right? They produces a similar result, yes. Method four also produces a similar result. This is important for me because if I run an online learning mechanism, I must ensure that my parameters evolve bounded. Okay. Otherwise, I have to train my perceptron for a particular amount of iterations, and I have to stop. Otherwise, as you see in this one, my parameters may go to infinity in some time, okay? This is important. You have to make sure that your parameters are either parameter adjustment is stopped at a particular time, or your parameters are ensured to be evolved in a bounded domain, okay? In none of them, I see this property here, okay? So my algorithm works, stops at a particular iteration number, and this picture is obtained in the parameter space. All right, in this case, the only difference is I have bias term, okay? This means that this surface can go up and down, okay? Surface does not have to pass through the origin. And in that case, as you see at the very beginning of the iterations, you see that the surface comes from somewhere very different to a position that passes through the origin. Origin is this green point in all those subplots, okay? Eta is a very small value, and you see that the algorithm with four parameters now is able to separate the two classes successfully. With four parameters, I will again go back and try to explain what is happening in the parameter space, okay? Here is my result. With the addition of this 5-4, okay, with the addition of this 5-4, indeed this is theta in our lecture notes. This is theta, okay? This 5-4 is theta. And method one is producing this result, method two produces this result, method three produces this result, and method four produces this result. Because of the overlap at the near origin elements, okay, there were, you know, crosses and circles that were in the misclassified region. The element, the fourth element, is fluctuating, as you see, it is trying to improve, but you know, probably the fourth element is not a convergent one. Well, it will fluctuate in between a finite bound, but it will not be converging, as you see in those four algorithms. Okay, so this is another picture that I have for the perceptron learning algorithms. In the coming slide, I will show you a checking of the four algorithms for four different overlap levels. I mean, if you choose this range, if you increase the width of this range, okay, 0.1 was our first trial. If you increase the value of that range, we will see the effect of this overlap on the convergence properties of those parameters. Okay, this is important for us because misclassification is sometimes very important, and we have the adverse effects of those misclassifications in the parameter space. Let me show that to you. Well, this is the this whole page is for the first method, okay? This whole page is for the first method. Here, there is no overlap. This is some overlap, 0.1. Overlap is increased, 0.2. And overlap is further increased, 0.3, okay? So go back here. My data was here, okay? My data was here, yes. And you are increasing the amount of overlapped region to see the performance, okay? Let's see that if there is no overlap, this is a very nice convergence, okay? If there is no overlap, there is a very nice convergence. And I take the norm of the parameter vector. This means that phi 1 square plus phi 2 square plus phi 3 square plus theta square, you take the square root of this summation, and you know that the length of that vector, parameter vector, is convergent. It converges to a finite, but this is not zero, okay? It is converging to a particular finite value, as you see here, okay? As you see here. There is no bias. So, well, this is phi 1 square plus phi 2 square plus phi 3 square, and you take the square root and obtain this figure. This is a nice plot, okay? And here you see the entire set of those planes. I did not delete the intermediate steps, and there is a tiny, tiny, I mean, adjustment, and it finds the optimum separator. Fine. If I increase the value of overlap, as you see here, the overlap is 0.1 for the first method. You see the data final value. This is the evolution of those planes, and this is the result. Okay, this is the result. So this result is not so bad. It is kind of convergent, probably, or fortunately, there are very few samples that over, probably no samples are overlapping here, okay? Or very tiny overlap is available. But when you increase the amount of that overlap here, you see that the parameters are losing their convergent behavior, and there is this fluctuating behavior in the second parameter. And basically, you see that there is no convergence at all here, okay? There is no convergence at all. For the fourth picture, you see that, well, it looks like converging. It looks like converging, but there is a fluctuation. This is a log scale. Well, this is very quickly reaching some value, but it is converging, and that convergence that took place here is within here. Since this is the linear time scale and this is a logarithmic time scale, that fluctuation is within this part. So overall, method one looks okay, looks good under certain conditions. And if there is this kind of a large overlap, again, the values I see here are found acceptable. Let's check for the second method. It is here. Basically, the parameters are, yeah, well, they are like flying. This is the norm of it. They are increasing for the no overlap case. For the tiny overlap case, again, it is increasing. For, you know, when overlap is 0.2, it is further increasing. When overlap is 0.3, it is basically, this second method is not able to produce a solution that converges, that forces the parameters to converge to particular values. Okay, this is the summary of the second method. And this is the summary of the third method. You see the parameters are very quickly converging. For the no overlap case, if there is no overlapping between those two classes, this is a very nice convergence. This is, well, saying that phi 2 is changing, phi 1 is changing. So there is some variation in the parameter value. There is no convergence at all. There is, well, particularly, there is a significant, well, fluctuation in significant amount of time. So it is possible to take the average of those values, but if you're increasing the amount of overlap, it is finding an average value with some misclassified samples. At each iteration, your algorithm tries to correct the misclassification, but it is unable to do that, and the result of that is this fluctuation. And when we come to the fourth algorithm, we see that for no overlap, the performance is fine. If the two classes are visibly separable, then the norm of the parameter vector is convergent. For the second case, well, I see something similar here. You see the parameter vector is not converging. Well, it looks like, but it does not, as you see here, okay? And it does not converge for the increased value of overlap. Well, there is a fantastic, you know, finding of the final value. As you see here, it finds the final value under severely overlapped case, but that causes a kind of fluctuation in the parameter value. This is 100, let's say this is 200, 300 is somewhere here. So the majority of the this point is around here, okay? Beyond that point, I'm observing a kind of fluctuation. So this is telling me that if you are using a, let's say, perceptron-based classifier, this is a, well, a sample discussion that you can encounter, okay? Basically, you have to look at the performance. These are the performance plots, okay? These are the upper ones are the performance plots. The upper ones are the performance plots, and the lower ones are the stability plots, okay? You have to make sure that your algorithm is safe to implement, okay? Your algorithm is safe to implement, which means that none of your parameters are going to infinity, okay? So you have to make sure that your algorithm is stable. Basically, these four algorithms are very famous and very widely used four algorithms within the context of perceptron learning. And I will stop here, and I have 1 minute left. 10 minutes later, we are gonna come together, okay?